Okay, so this is the solution for the problem set matrix zeros. You're given a matrix m cross n containing m rows and n columns, and it has integers. Now, if the particular integer is zero, you want to convert its entire row and column to zero. In the case like this zero will convert all of the elements in this containing row to zero, and all of the elements in this containing column also to zero. So in the end, you will have a matrix like this. Now you actually don't need to return anything. You have to do things in place, which means that return type is none. Cool. Let's look at a more visual representation of what's happening. What is sort of the goal here? What's sort of happening here if you look at it abstractly? If you look at it from a above perspective, you just need to know what rows are going to get converted to zero and what columns are going to get converted to zero. And you can do that simply by marking these columns or marking these rows. The yellow squares are, by the way, elements which are zeros. And you can just mark these rows and columns to be zero. And so you can see these markers over here, which we can have in another data structure. Let's go ahead and actually implement this. We'll have this rows and columns data structure, which are actually sets. And we'll need two sets because one is for storing all of the rows and one is for storing all of the columns. Okay, once we have that, now we want to iterate over all of the elements in the matrix. And what do you want to do? You want to check if the element in ij is 0. If it's a 0, what do you do? If it's a 0, then you want to add its row index to the set. And if it's 0, you also want to add its column index to the set. So let's actually do that. Rows dot add this particular row and columns dot add this particular index. Okay, we're almost done. At the end, what do you want to do? You want to convert all of these elements. If a particular row is in rows, you want to convert it to zero. If a particular column is in columns, you want to convert it to zero. So now we'll just check if I in rows or j in columns, what do you do then? Matrix of ij goes to zero. We'll do a quick sanity check here. Cool. This will also work, by the way. Let me just submit it. And let's run through the space-time complexities. And the time complexity here is m cross n. As you can see, it has two nested loops like this, so it's m into n. Pretty simple. What is the space complexity? The space complexity says that what's the worst possible case? The worst possible case is where all of the elements in the matrix are zero. So the row is full of all the indices and the column is also full of all the indices, which means that the row length is m and the column length is n. Summation of both of these is m plus n, and thus the complexity of order m plus n space. And this is single improvement uses this amount of space, but it's still not the best solution. So what is the best solution then? Let's come back to the idea we had in the very beginning. It was to mark rows and columns to be zero. We needed a way to say that this column is going to get converted to zero, or this particular row is going to get converted to zero. Can we do that within the matrix itself? Let's look at another example, and I've just removed the green and blue coloration here. And now what we'll do is within the matrix, we'll mark these particular rows or columns which are going to get converted to zero. How we'll do that? We'll just make the first element in the given row or column both zeros. So the black part here you see is going to be zero element. And now the problem is again solved. We've just sort of, instead of having it outer like this, you just have it inside of the matrix itself. Pretty cool, right? how do you figure out the solution then? See, if it's one, if it's a case like one, which has a row and a column leader, so a row leader is this, and a column leader is this, if it has both of them, then it's going to get to convert it to zero. If it's a case like two, which has only a row leader, then it will also get converted to zero. If it's a case like three, same story. If it's a case like four, however, which has no row leader or a column leader, what do we do then? We'll keep the element as is. No need to convert it to zero. Right? Make sense? Let's look at a slightly different example. I've just moved this zero above by one. And so this is the configuration now. This element, by the way, now is its own column leader. And that's fine. That's allowed. The tricky thing that happens here is, take this node, for example, this particular square. Now, does it have a row leader? No, it does not have. Does it have a column leader though? You look at above and you'll see, okay, there's an element here which says it's zero, which means that this entire column will now get converted to zero. Although this is not a leader of columns, this is a leader of this row. See, this comes from this element. And so we have this sort of edge case here, which says that if a zero is at row zero, column zero, if it's at the zero zero element in the matrix, then it'll pose a problem. You won't know if it's a row leader or a column leader. Okay, how do we solve that? We can solve this by splitting this problem into three parts. See, if it's inside this green part, leftover part here, then it's fine. We do the computations as is, as we saw before. This is all the four points we need to keep in mind. The green part is here is pretty trivial. But both of these cases are now interesting because they say, hey, if it's a column leader, if it's a row leader, we'll put it over here. And if it's a column leader, we'll mark it as so and put it over here. What I mean is, if there is a zero element over here, we're going to mark this row. We're going to say that, okay, yeah, this row also has to get converted to zero. If there is an element over here, we're going to mark this entire column and say that, yeah, this is also going to go to zero. Okay. If this is confusing, let's actually go ahead and implement this, and it will solve a lot of questions that way. So the first computation we want to do, actually, let's just keep these loops because we're going to use them again and again. What's the first part of computation that you want to do? See, the leftover case is very simple, right? This will be handled automatically. But you also need the information of row leaders and column leaders before that. So let's first make row leaders and column leaders. How would you do that? See, if the element at ij is zero, then the matrix of I zero is same as the matrix of zero j, which is the same as zero. What I've done essentially here is the same thing. I'm looking at a particular element ij, and I'm going to go to its first column and make it zero. I'm also going to go to its first row element and make it zero. This is basically marking these black spots here. As simple as that. Cool. Once we have that, we can now actually do the second part, which was the leftover part of things. Okay, so leftover wanted what? We want to now go from one comma m to one comma. And the computation is very simple. If the matrix at I0 is 0, or the matrix at 0j is also 0, either of these cases or both of these together, that is also allowed, will make this element ij as a 0. Now we've handled this leftover case. How do we handle both of these? We need another piece of information. A single variable which says that, okay, this is a case of row or this is a case of column. So let's have is row and is column here. Now, what does it mean to be in a row? It means that when does this case get activated? When there is an element over here, or element over here, or element over here. Somewhere in the first row, but in all of the columns, there is an element 0. Let's check that. So we'll use the any operator, which will return true if any of the values in the iterable is true. And what we want to check is matrix of 0, row 0 and column j for j in range of n. Is row will now be true if there is a single 0 element over here, or if even if there are more elements. So say that there is a 0 element over here, which means that this entire row would get activated, or alternatively is row would get to set to true. Similarly, we can just go over the columns and we'll make this 0, as the column is 0 and we are going to iterate over the rows. So INM. Pretty simple. At the end, what do we want to do? If it's the case of row, if is row, which means that this row, this entire row is going to go to 0, just make it 0. So we'll iterate over this again for j in range of n. The matrix of row 0, column j, is going to go to 0. Same thing again for column. So if is call is true, iterate over all of the rows and make them 0. Make their first element 0. And we'll have I over here. Cool, let's do a quick sanity check. Okay, it's saying wrong answer. Cool, I'll take a quick debugging break and then get back to you. Okay, right, so we wanted to check if the element here was 0. That was the issue. And now it should work. Cool. Okay, let's do a quick complexity analysis here. Is row is a single element. Is column is also a single element. M and N are also single elements. We're not using any amount of variables or lists or anything like that. So the space complexity comes to order of 1, which is the most optimal solution. To make things more clear, let's do a quick dry run or see what would happen in a case like this. Okay, so what is the M? M is the number of rows here, so M is 3 and N is 4. Okay, now what is row, if it's true or false? Now is row checks if in the 0 row, across all the columns, are there zeros? If there is even a single 0, that's good for us. Is there a single 0 in this row? Yes, it is true. So this is true. Let's just put it here. What about is call? Similar logic, we'll look at this column and we'll look at all of the rows in this column. So 0, 3, 1. Is there a 0 in there? Yes, there is. So we'll put a T here. Now we'll iterate over all of the elements. And if the matrix of ij is 0, we're going to have the headers as 0. So the header for this, the leaders for this is going to be 0 and 0, this the same element again. And the leaders for this is going to be what? The row leader is now this element and the column leader is itself. So this element is the row and column leader of itself and also the row leader of this element. And this element is now the column leader of itself. Pretty weird, but yes, that is how it is. Now we'll iterate over all of the elements in the remaining part and we'll check if the headers or the leaders of them are 0 or not. So now we'll look at 3, 1, they're going to go to 0. 1 and 2 share the same row leader, so they're also going to go to 0. And then 2 and 5 are going to 0. Two last pieces of computation. Oh, right. Yeah, so actually 3 and 1 and 1 and 2 are not going to be considered here. My bad. only the elements that are going to be considered here are going to be 4, 5, 2, 3, 1, 5. So 1, 2, and 3, 1 are not going to be considered in this loop, but in these two subsequent loops. So A0 will what check what? For the row 0, it is going to check over all of its columns and going to make all of them 0. So 1, 2 will be set to 0. 1, 2 and set to 0. And now A's column will set 3 and 1 to 0. So this case actually shows all of the three cases. In this loop, what's happening? We're going to consider 4, 5, 2, 3, 1, 5. So 2, 5 becomes 0. In this case, we'll look at this. Row 0 and across all of the columns. And in this case, column 0 and across all of the rows. So cool. Yeah, this is a proper explanation and solution of two solutions, actually. One of them taking order of m plus n space complexity, and the other is a constant space complexity. So yeah, that's it for the solution of set matrix zeros. Cool.